And if I can only access 8% of that land, for me, that's just a huge problem for us as a society.
And this is the big thing, is that the people who enjoy these fabulous places, they have to be part of the equation in how we deal with this beautiful place.
But that won't be a zero tolerance by Forestry England. We will come in and flatten things. We will come in and remove. We will issue signage and give fair warning.
You've got people who won't either want to provide a facility or enjoy the process, but there's been no way for them to do it legit.
For the last 26 years, riding bikes has been a huge part of my life. Riding to school, with the family, on the international race circuit, and more recently just for simple escapes from the front door. The trails we ride give us the freedom of climbing to the top of a mountain and blasting back down through the trees. They build communities and sporting legends. But many of these trails don't have any formal or secure standing. We also share these places with others, and whoever owns or manages the land. Through my time riding off-road, I've been told that I shouldn't be somewhere with my bike, seen tensions with other users, and the heartache caused by the removal of hand-built trails. So we visited riders and organisations across mainland Britain to find out what challenges mountain bike trails face, how people are working to overcome them, and what the future could look like. To start with, where have mountain bike trails come from?
The specialised off-road line continues to pioneer new technology. Important innovations include...
Well, mountain bikes kind of came along 83, 85 sort of thing. You'd start seeing the first of the kind of specialised muddy fox, folk like that coming in, riding in the forests, finding places to ride, using forest roads.
I've been coming in here for 25 plus years probably. I used to ride up from my mum and dad's house and do laps of this forest, and at that point it was mainly like fire roads and little bits of rock on fire roads, but it was pretty fire roady.
We started meeting up here on a Wednesday evening, a handful of us, so it's been going 20 years basically, so, and it's evolved into what it is today.
We started building trails to actually get folk off forest roads, and we started building trails to reduce unauthorised trail building, because there was a lot of unauthorised trail building going on.
I feel really fortunate and lucky where I live, and having Horncliffe Woods on my doorstep, it's really technical in there, it's really rocky, it's really rooty, and it's always been that way really. That's where I think I honed a lot of my skills and got good on sort of technical trails. I can carry speed really well.
And as the bikes got better and better, it just helped with that. You could ride more technical stuff.
As bikes have evolved from the early clunkers to the technologically advanced machines we ride today, riders have sought out more challenges, and trails have also evolved to meet that demand.
So folk had bought the bikes, didn't have places to ride them. Cyclists are really good at constructing their own trails and things, and they're kind of like grassroots driven, really good kind of volunteer culture in amongst cycling and things, so they just went out and built their own trail.
I used to think, why haven't we got our own?
Yeah.
Why haven't we got our own trails?
Hand-built trails define mountain biking for so many of us, but trail centres are an important gateway into the sport.
We had a real boom in trail centres in the early 2000s. They started off predominantly through the Seven Steins and then spread throughout Scotland. At that time though, actually a lot of relationships and partnerships weren't there, and actually there was quite a big degree of falling out between the mountain bike community, Forestry and Land Scotland, other national agencies. We weren't working as effectively as it could.
And then suddenly, as 2001 came along, trail centres opened. And it was like, wow. And it just changed, it changed the cycling completely. They put a downhill track in, as you know, and everything became popular. It was great.
But what the trail centres do is they introduce massive, massive, massive amounts of people to the sport. And so you've had this huge bulge of uptake in mountain biking, and there's thousands and thousands and thousands of people get riding. And some of those thousands of people move on, and they want to ride tracks like this. At least in Scotland at the minute, there's nothing like this provided officially. So that huge weight of people shifts into the unofficial network.
first and original is Ron Durrell. Oh. After the man himself.
I didn't name Ron Durrell because we didn't know what to call it. So we just said, you build it and we're naming it after you. So we made a plaque and nailed it to the top tree. I was a bit embarrassed.
But not.
Yeah. We're also expanding. Mountain biking is getting a lot bigger. So we're expanding into different trail networks, into different woodlands and into different areas. And that is encroaching on some of the walkers that have been using those trails for a long time or other users in those situations. So we need to be conscious of that when we're going to these new places.
In 2010, developing mountain biking in Scotland was set up to help manage this increase in users and work with riding groups across the country.
Developing Mountain Scotland is part of Scottish Cycling. Our remit is to oversee the national strategy for mountain biking across the country. For that, we look to try and grow the number of participants who are riding it, see if those participants want to go fast themselves, and then have we got a system to support them so we can get Scots achieving the world stage of it. And also, how can mountain biking contribute to our local economies in a sustainable way, growing tourism, having more products developed in Scotland?
Mountain biking has enriched my life in so many ways, and the benefits it brings to us all are undeniable.
We've got the Mountain Bike World Cup in Fort William, which has sort of given the Highlands the recognition that it currently has. But beyond that, yeah, we've got, you know, Woodland single track, we've got rider built stuff. And we've also got big hill riding as well, going out into the big wide open areas of the Highlands.
As soon as I got home from school, I'd be straight out on my mountain bike. For me, it was freedom. I loved being outdoors from being a little kid. And once I'd got that mountain bike, I could go further and explore more and see different things.
How was it with Manon? Were you faster than her?
Yes.
How much faster?
100% faster.
If you put well-being into the context of mountain biking, it gives you so many things. Biking isn't just about your bike. Your bike is your tool to get you to places. You know, it really helps with your physical well-being in terms of getting out there, getting exercise, and feeling fit. It also helps with your social well-being as well, making friends, connecting with people, being part of a community. And the third thing is around your emotional well-being, connecting with nature, how the outdoors really just helps you reset.
Studies have shown how much mountain biking can benefit local economies, with the economic value it brings increasing all the time.
So you've got three good cafes. Traquair Arms is the busiest it's ever been, that's bike driven. There's the Bike Lodge doing accommodation on the high street. There's Innerhaven doing bike accommodation. The Uplift's booked out every weekend. It's not like one or two businesses. It's massive.
While there are an estimated 1.5 million trips to Scotland on a mountain bike per year, it's important to understand that mountain biking is just one part of a bigger picture.
Someone published an article and the headline was something like mountain biking saved Innerleithen. And the rage on the local internet was, like, off the charts. And it's fair, like, it's an obvious exaggeration. Mountain biking has not saved Innerleithen. But tourism is saving Innerleithen. And mountain biking is, you can argue about how big a chunk of tourism it is, but it's big.
People have come here. I think it's helped build Jamie's business, obviously. He already had a successful bike shop. Caffey is constantly visited by the bikers.
A lot of the local kids, yeah. Saturday morning and stuff.
There's like, gangs of like little kids, yeah. Riding around and wheeling up and down, and you know, the level has blown up as well. Like, you know, they come along and they maintain and make the trails safer and better for themselves and us, and yeah, it's good.
Yeah, I've used all these trails training for the EWS, being sick. Good comparison to those sort of trails, and there's rough tracks, tight tracks and super techie tracks as well, so it's mint.
I'm from Abergavenny. I moved down to Caerphilly, like properly into the valleys. It's more like natural stuff around me in Abergavenny, pretty chill bridleways and stuff, but this is proper trails that you'd get in like races, and yeah, it's transformed my riding.
It's bonkers because you've got so much choice, and I think we're very, very lucky for that. Certainly in South Wales, probably more than most parts of the country would have thought, you know?
To the majority, mountain biking is simply riding bikes. But to others, there is a looming problem. An increase in uptake, digital apps, and what was once perceived as fair game by many, digging your own trail, has not gone unnoticed. Around the country, conversations are taking place about these wild or unauthorised trails, and what the future holds for them. Some people are paying closer attention than others.
I want the industry to wake up. Can I say that?
Yeah.
This is not pointing fingers at anybody. This is like a collective. If I could point fingers like this, we all need to wake up.
They've always known that the off-piste trails are there, but they've just kind of turned a blind eye to them. In the last year, because there's been an increase of rider and an increase of trail builders, they've actually started to look into it and realise that it's not against the law for us to be riding in any part of the woods, but it is against the law for us to actually be building the trail.
England is different to Wales and Scotland, and we have a lot more public pressure. There's just no doubt about that. And I can say that with working in Scotland as well, I can see that.
Our speed of development has been really big. I think it's largely been massively positive. However, we just need to look at it in terms of what are the risks for mountain biking as well going forward. What things could happen, could make the sport go backwards, that could prevent our access happening.
This is how I've been explained it. If someone comes off, hurts herself really bad, life-changing injuries, which we know happens, and they chase NRW, NRW are going to put it straight onto us.
Slinging.
As it stands today, UK law states that the landowner is ultimately responsible for what happens on their land. Whether invited or not, they are liable for a person's safety.
Because everybody says, no, we won't do that. We're good guys. We'll never sue you. But that's just not how it's going to stack up. That's our duty as public servants, is to very carefully manage the Welsh Government woodland estate and to absolutely minimise the amount of libelous claims that might result from this wild trail building and riding activity.
You know, so the mother and toddler out walking the dog, and there's an unauthorised trail that's got a kind of gap jump over that trail or whatever. If they're jumping that trail and smack into the mother and kid, that's your folk that you've failed to protect. It's not so much the rider, the rider's kind of accepting the risk.
I remember my first conversation with NRW was basically, you've built trails in my back garden. Well, we're not happy. That was the initial start of it all, really. And they were threatening to take them down, bulldoze them, and prosecute at one point, weren't they? You know, they wanted to blame some.
300-odd Strava segment wild trails, and whilst we have about 250,000 riding the official trails, we've got over 330,000 people riding wild trails. So it's pretty significant stuff going on in wild trails, and that's why we can't ignore it.
They know that they can't stop people building the trails because it's always going to happen, but they just want to make sure that we're building in safe areas, not building anything ridiculously stupid or in nature reserves, or we're actually taking in consideration that other people are using the forest.
A misconception is that Forestry England will always say no. That's not correct. What Forestry England will do as part of due diligence is correctly check what pressures are on that land. It could be that some areas will actually be allowed to become a formal trail network with involvement of a local group, or it could be that it's a small piece of land which has got too many environmental constraints, has got too many land management issues, operational issues, and can't happen.
We really see the massive value in a kind of the hand-built and the natural and enduro trail network that we have in Scotland. It keeps people riding what they want, challenges. It helps our fast riders go fast. Some of our best places in Scotland are really based on those trails. And we have tourism as a result of those trails as well. So they're massively important. At the same time, though, we've got to recognise that those paths have concerns from landowners. So they have the liability of having them on their land. They have the potential for environmental impacts that we might not even see. Even being on the ground, we might not see them. It might be raptors, protected species, plants and fauna that we don't understand are there. And thirdly, there's the social interaction with it as well, with those paths. How do they interact with other users? So we needed to come up with a framework to manage that. And we've come up with a guide to unauthorised trails, which is a bit of a clunky term, but it was the best we came up with at the time.
So you've got people who either want to provide a facility or enjoy the process, but there's been no way for them to do it legit. And then you give them that way and they can come.
as we move forward, we've got to accept that there are still going to be some places that there's been trails built and they're never going to be acceptable to us because they present too high a risk. So we're going to have to inevitably remove some trails in some locations.
We all need to understand and recognise what goes into putting trails on the ground, you know, and it's not a hat in the hand charity approach. It's like, it is cool, it is rock and roll, but it's hard.
If it doesn't exist and a forestry manager doesn't know about it, then it can just get felled. And you've got areas like this now, and I think, you know, you could use Ballater as an example. It's becoming like that, where a whole local economy depends on it. Where the felling of a trail is now, doesn't just affect like the 40 local mountain bikers who love it. It sort of smashes a whole area. So you kind of, as a rider and as a builder, and just part of the local community, you just want to see these things safe. And the only way to make them safe is to make them formal.
Across the country, riders are getting organised and working with others to give their trails a secure future. We wanted to find out how they're doing it.
Nice, rolly speed down here.
We did initially have a telling off when we first started. They gave us a basic set of rules, unofficial, and we adhered to it. Didn't step on their toes, so they sort of went with it.
Yeah. I think there's room for informal relationships as well. Just mountain bikers speaking to landowners. But trails that are starting to be used more and mean more to local communities, we do need to have a more organised way of doing that. I think trails associations fit really nicely into that part of the framework.
We've tried various things over the years. I think trail organisations are going to be successful. Well, they have to be, really. But, you know, we haven't really tried this in the past, but we're doing it on a fairly big scale, and hopefully it'll work, you know, and it'll be good for everybody. What have you got in trails organisation? You've got skills, you've got knowledge, you've kind of got attitude, huge amount of experience. These people know what they're doing, but you're lacking that kind of training side of things. Us as an organisation, working with a competent organisation really makes us feel much more secure.
Probably Strava has probably been our saving grace with them, because you can look at a Strava and you can see how many people are riding them. And our last chat with NRW was saying that there's more people riding our trails than the official trails, which is suddenly, well, we can't just take them away.
You know, as the sport grows, we need more operational needs, logistics, communications is huge. But ultimately, if you don't have a trail network, you don't have a good bike race. So trails are first, and if the trails aren't necessarily there, we look to work with the destination to try and build what would be needed for the event.
There's a framework in place nationally now of guidance where if you want to trail build, you submit where you want to build your trail and a description of what the trail will be on a map. That goes to the land manager and they have to make a decision. Hopefully someone gets a thumbs up and then we just go and do some massive community digs.
When I was at work, I was close to the rights of way team and I used to harass them on a daily basis about some of the decisions. In the end, they invited me to the local access forum and then told me that there was no point because they couldn't speak to mountain bikers. So I started to set up a group.
I don't really know how, I got into the Tweed Valley Trails Association. There was about 20 of us and then there was three left when it came to the paperwork. Yeah. And actually set us up as a charity. It was me, Chris and Neil.
Everybody got a different opinion. A lot, like this boy's saying, yeah, Sodom sort of thing. Let's just do what we want. Well, we don't want that now. I was all for let's just do what we want at one stage.
Forgiveness is easier than getting permission. But we've gone past that now. You've had to go past that now.
I see a climbing forum, and any time I was out riding, I basically stopped riding and said, next Monday, there's going to be a meeting here, and it was just, I had no idea how many people to expect. And we had about 70 people.
It is probably going to be more and more important that those discussions happen. And also, as well, from the other side of it, it's really important that landowners engage in that, that they're part of the solution here as well. And they need to be able to work at a pace that means that people don't just go, it's easier to ask for forgiveness than permission.
We've had our Wild Trails strategy, signed off at the highest level. Now, upon becoming aware of a Wild Trail, NRW staff, they make a record of it, and what the local land management team need to do, with my assistance, is to do some kind of risk assessment of what's going on there. We then got to decide what are suitable control measures in this environment.
The NRWR sort of like dragged my heels a bit, whether or not management have changed hands and they're not that interested in the mountain bike development type thing, even though there's a massive opportunity. Surely there's someone
somewhere can help us out, doesn't it? Gotta be.
Nest Resource Wales own the land. We lease it from them. It's on a 10-year lease, which is up for renewal at the moment. So we're just talking to them about that. And that's one of the reasons it's really important that we do keep our commitments, especially in the litter, ecology and stuff like that, because if we're not looking after this place, then that's a good excuse for them to take it away from us.
I'm hoping over the next couple of years that we'll have a lot more recognised wild trail venues where we've worked with local people and we've agreed what's acceptable or isn't, and that we've got regular groups set up and working with us in some locations.
The soil research and dig days we have, we work with volunteer-led groups that go and support and maintain all the trails in these places, you know, at weekends in their own time, and they have all the tools and equipment. But sometimes they don't have enough hands.
You put the word out to a bunch of mountain bikers, we had 30 people doing it on that day.
So many people don't realise what actually goes into maintaining a trail, let alone building new ones. And, you know, I'm guilty of it. We're probably all guilty of it, of sitting at home and then just going out and riding your bike and you're like, oh, new tracks. Oh, yeah, that's cool. And, you know, and you don't really think of who's actually put in some serious man hours.
Look at this trail. This trail's not actually that long. And the water running down it has made a big rut down it. It probably, for the people that first built this, I bet they don't ride it anymore because it's not as fun for them. And it was a bit loamy and a bit. So I think that's why new trails get built all the time, because people get bored of the ones they've built.
And it's pointless. It's pointless just building new trails all the time. If you've got 50 trails, but 20 of them are never ridden, you can make 20 new ones, but fixing those 20 rather than having this kind of like, and it used to be like that here, and everyone's been guilty of it. Like, you build a trail, everyone rides until it's thrashed, and then a new trail would get built and everyone moves, and that process repeats, and it's not that healthy. And then the cycle has switched now to taking all those ones that had been forgotten and turning them into like this sort of thing.
So far we've talked a lot about hand-built mountain bike specific trails. But what about the paths that have existed for years in our landscapes, long before bikes came about? Once again, Scotland is way ahead of the curve on this.
Scotland has one of the most regressive land ownership systems in the world.
And so the right to roam was really born out of that. And what has come out of one of the most aggressive land ownership systems of the world is one of the most progressive land access pieces of legislation in the world.
I remember growing up, that's what my dad always said, is there's no trespassing rules in Scotland. You can do this. This is your country. You can go out and you can explore it. But he also ingrained in us that right does come with responsibilities as well, that you have to go out and take care of where you are. You have to appreciate it, enjoy it, to do that. And those two things are really inseparable.
In Scotland, whether you're on foot, bike or horseback, you have a shared right to explore these amazing places. But across the rest of the UK, access rights are divided by user group across a rights of way network.
For Wales, is it something like about 25% of rights of way are accessible legally by or legitimately by bike. So that 75% of the paths in Wales we can't ride on.
While people have had to battle for their rights of access in the Peak District through trespass, you get beyond that situation where you can actually sit down around a table and say, OK, what's best for people and what's best for the landscape?
Improving access is being looked at in Wales, but there are concerns from other users that we need to be aware of.
But the safety one, I mean, you know as well as I do, is an issue. I mean, there are an awful lot of mountain bikers that just don't seem to know how to ride around walkers, horses, dog walkers, whatever. And it can quite quickly gain momentum in a meeting. If somebody's had a bad experience or had a complaint or got a letter from somebody, I think that's the big issue.
With, you know, the Ramblers, you want to be on a level with, you know, horse riding groups. And at the moment, we're not. So we don't want to be the people apologising all the time. We're sorry that someone did this. We're sorry that, you know, someone sped through your picnic. You know, we have to not have that to apologise for.
That is a significant part of what we do, is putting the word out that mountain biking is a reputable part of the outdoor world.
If it is a publicly owned landscape, then people should be able to have a say in what happens here. And so this is where Ride Sheffield got involved in terms of advising us, helping us design a better connected network of access, and then doing it, which they've been brilliant at.
After hearing about where our trails come from and how groups are working to formalise them, we wanted to ask what the future of mountain biking might look like.
The bike industry in general should really take trail building and funding of these local groups seriously, because without it, we wouldn't have a sport.
It's people like Neil Carnegie, you know, that are out there, and others. There's so many others like him in the Tweed Valley doing some incredible work, and this beautiful craftsmanship of what they're creating. And we're just going out riding them all the time. So what could I give in return? What can I do to support the trails? You know they're going to get hammered. More and more people ride them.
I think after the coal mine shut, that was it now.
Yeah,
we had
that
some
was
big
it.
Industry
yeah.
going on. The valleys have been dead since this.
Gone.
You know, people have to travel out to the valleys to work. This is a big industry which we could, you know, capitalise on for the local communities and everybody, really. And everybody involved in mountain biking. More places to ride, you know. It's a win-win.
I think the mountain bike world has really sort of pioneered how to do this stuff well with the materials that are available. Mountain bikers are actually leading the way in giving us the solutions to maintaining some of our upland paths.
Going forward, if the expansion of mountain biking carries on as rapidly as it is, then we're going to have to manage building more trails to keep our sport looking good.
Now feels now to me and to lots of people, I think, like it needs another step change, because it's now gotten so busy with thousands of riders per month and 4 or 5 events per year that kind of getting beyond what a handful of volunteers can maintain.
I think ultimately you're going to see, whether it's local communities, government, something, funded trail crews, which I think there just has to be to maintain the kind of the rise in user numbers. I don't really see any other way.
The challenge has been sometimes people don't want to get involved with a local group, or they find it a bit challenging for the politics. My encouragement would be is definitely go and get in touch with a group. You might help shape that group. You might help grassroots. It's came a very long way in the UK over the last 20 years.
What I'd love is like a Finale Ligue area. Do you know what I mean? It's like with the valleys, it'd be great to get people coming here from miles away riding not just our trails but all of the trails, with uplift buses going here, there and everywhere, accommodation in the valleys, lovely restaurants in the valleys. How good would that be? How big is Finale and how many bike shops are they? You know what I mean? We're massive, you know what I mean? It could be that's what I'd like to see, something along those lines. So, but
very ambitious.
Yeah, but well, you know.
Ideally, in the future, like it would be a dream for it to be turned into an official
bike park,
trail centre, some sort,
nice flowy,
you know,
blue trails. Yeah, for everyone to ride. Yeah. It's quite difficult.
Along with like some official, more advanced trails, and yeah, just hopefully the right people make the right decisions, isn't it?
If we can get that right, and I think what we're building here though is where mountain biking really has a firm place within the fabric of the outdoors in Scotland. And that means that riders have going to be will have the same access rights as walkers, and we can respect walkers' needs and whilst getting walkers to respect our needs.
Like, if going outdoors makes you a happy, healthy person, and what we're trying to build is a happy, healthy nation, then how, like, that can't be seen as a problem. It just needs education, it needs time, it needs resource, it needs commitment, and they're all difficult things. And so we just need to champion them and make sure that we are contributing to that dialogue. Because if we don't contribute to that dialogue, the dialogue will be made for us.
What's been clear to see is that it's people who are at the heart of shaping not only the line a trail takes, but also its fate. And these trails are the basis upon which our fun is built. Supporting these groups is one of the best ways we can tackle the challenges trails face behind the scenes. By combining our stoke and collaborating with others, we can really progress and help build an exciting future for our sport, not just on this island, but for mountain biking everywhere.
You know, it could have taken one person a year to build. It could have taken another person 10 years to just even break ground, you know. So to me, the soul of mountain biking is the trail and everything that had to fall in place to put that trail there. Yeah.
Hopefully in England, at some point, we'll see again a resurrection of an independent mountain bike group for England. I think that'd be really good.
Neil, Carnegie?
Close enough.
Which one?
Let's do that again.
Let's roll
that from
can
the top.
Can you say it?
Straight
into
the B-roll.
Carnegie.